again, for the time that you've given us, the breath that we borrow. It's all of you, it's all for you. And it's, we do strive, we do desire to please you, to hear your words and do them. And however imperfectly we do that, I pray that you would look upon our efforts with some favor, that you would bless our efforts for your glory, and we pray in Christ's name. Amen. A quick introduction or review. We are going through the distinctives of what makes IRBC a little bit different, or maybe a lot different from other churches that you might attend. As we go ahead, taking the first week, and going through our statement of faith on some of the things that we think are distinctive in there. This is our third, or perhaps fourth week on the kingdom. Now, what we've been doing is we've been using a handout of the International Church Council Project. The churchcouncil.org is their website, and they've published 25 different statements on various heresies afflicting the church today. And this is statement number 4 of their proposed new creed. They hope to have a creed developed and published by 2017 after review by many, by projects like what we have in the United States in many different countries. They want to get everybody together, have a big meeting in 2016, and then publish their new creed in 2017. Their statement on the kingdom is not mainstream anymore. Used to be. It's not any longer, but we can find nothing to disagree with in their statement on the kingdom. And so we've been through several weeks of this. We got through article number 24 of this on the Lord's Prayer, which essentially equated the Lord's Prayer to the Great Commission. Our next article would be on the kingdom of the Holy Spirit. For those of you who have brought your handout along, we'll be reading from article number 25. Actually, we'll probably just give this a glance. I don't think that it's all that different from what most mainstream evangelical churches would profess. Article 25. We affirm that the kingdom of God, however guaranteed in the promises of the Father and embodied in the person of Christ, can never gain entrance or come to full realization in the fabric of human life apart from the agency of the Holy Spirit, who is indispensable to ensure kingdom entrance, to seal kingdom membership, to implement kingdom obedience, to build kingdom character, to furnish kingdom gifts, to empower to kingdom outreach, to produce kingdom growth, and to secure kingdom victory. We deny that character strength, personal charisma, skillful management, creative imagination, evident talents, financial strength, political action, or educational prowess by themselves can build or advance the kingdom of God. Again, we find the power of the statement in the denial aspect of it. I think we deny that by strength of character, personal charisma, skillful management, or imagination, especially financial strength, these things will not advance the kingdom of God. It's required that the Holy Spirit be involved in advancing the kingdom. Only as we're empowered by the Spirit, and only as the Spirit applies that to the people to whom we're witnessing or that we're interacting with, will the kingdom advance. That is the main thrust of this particular article, and I don't think anybody's really going to argue with that. We all have a high view of God here, and most people do have that view of the Holy Spirit. I think that Now, I'll be happy to hear from those who would disagree with that, or examples, if there's any discussion that we'd like to have about the Holy Spirit advancing the kingdom, I'd be happy to entertain the discussion at this point. I think especially telling was the, one of the proof verses that they gave here was Acts 9:31. After Paul's conversion, Acts 9:31, then had the churches rest throughout all Judea and Galilee and Samaria, and were edified, and walking in the fear of the Lord and in the comfort of the Holy Ghost were multiplied. So it really talks about how the Holy Ghost was multiplying and advancing the kingdom. So our next article here is something we touched on last time, but perhaps we want to beat this up a little bit more. It's article number 26, the church is responsible for advancing the kingdom. We affirm that God holds the body of Christ responsible for advancing his kingdom on earth to whatever extent God has ordained it. By applying his biblical principles through service in all spheres of human activity in all nations prior to our Lord's glorious return, we deny, A, that any belief regarding the timing of Christ's second coming, the sequence of events leading up to it, and the possible extent of the kingdom's growth prior to Christ's return releases anyone from such responsibility. We deny, B, that seeking to apply biblical principles to the stewardship of all earthly creation detracts from the believer's heavenly hope. And we deny, C, that one can properly lead without an attitude of humble servitude. These affirmations and denials that make there are people who don't believe that the church, the body of Christ as the church, is responsible for these things. That we, as individuals, have these responsibilities, but that the church is God's main instrument for advancing the kingdom. And so that's what the thrust of this article number 26 is about, is that it's the church and through the ministry of the church and its people that these things are going to happen. We get into, as one of the proof verses, we have one of my favorite verses out of the Old Testament, and all Deuteronomy 4, 5 through 8. Behold, I have taught you statutes and judgments, even as the Lord my God commanded me, that ye should do so in the land whither ye go to possess it. Keep therefore and do them, for this is your wisdom and your understanding in the sight of the nations, which shall hear these statutes and say, surely this great nation is a wise and understanding people. For what nation is there so great who hath God so nigh unto them as the Lord our God is in all things that we call upon him for? And what nation is there so great that hath statutes and judgment so righteous as all this law, which I set before you this day? So here we have, and this is actually getting into the church and Israel. Here we have Israel being told, you, the church, that's the way we can read this, you, the church, have this great God. And by living according to statutes and the laws and the precepts set before you this day, you are a wonderful example. You are going to advance the kingdom because people will flock unto you to say, wow, you are living peace and harmony, and it's wise and just. We are drawn to this justice. If we as the church would act this way, as the body universal, people would see us as distinctive. Well, lots of churches today are just hangouts. They're hideouts. And we wish to be different. Pastor exhorts up here. Here we are, week 22. Imagine that, week 22 already. And week after week, he's got to get out there and do this. And obey these laws. Look at how good they are. Look at how gracious God has been to give us this body of law, this justice. And this, it's such a wonderful thing. And if we live it, we will be distinct. We will be different people. And it gives us an opportunity to talk to our neighbors. We talked a lot about humbling today in our service. There's another proof text that in here is in Matthew. Matthew 18, 1 to 4. When the disciples came to Jesus saying, "Who is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven?" And Jesus called a little child unto him, set him in the midst of them, and said, "Verily I say to you, except ye be converted and become as little children, ye shall not enter into the kingdom of heaven. Whosoever therefore shall humble himself as this little child, the same is greatest in the kingdom of heaven." By humbling ourselves, we are admitting that we are not the king, we are not the judge, we are submitting ourselves and being distinct. And we're going to get to this a little bit later as we wrap up the kingdom, but it's this humbling ourselves and being submissive to our God and King that helps to advance the kingdom by being good citizens of the kingdom. So, it's vital that we understand that we have a charge here as a church to be God's vanguard in His kingdom. He is the King and the Judge, and we are the main instrument that He uses here. The denial that we have to worry about when Christ comes back. We deny that any belief regarding the timing of Christ's second coming releases anyone from responsibility. That's an important point. Again, we'll talk about the eschatology towards the end of our discussion today, but we're not to be waiting on mountaintops, setting times and dates when Christ comes back and worrying about the end time, the end. We're in the end time, but the end times are designed, or described, that is, in the Bible as being when the kingdom advances. And so we are not to be waiting, as I said, on the mountaintop, sell all our possessions and wait for Christ to come back. No, we're supposed to use our gifts, use our fortunes to advance the kingdom as good citizens. That's an important point, that we not be sitting around being bus stop Christians, just waiting for the bus to come and rapture us all out of here and get us out. Get us out of Dodge, as I've heard said once or twice. That's, I think, the major thrust here of the church being responsible for advancing the kingdom. We could read all of the proof verses. Are there questions, comments that on the church? Okay.
Wait.
Yes.
We were discussing it among ourselves.
Well, I wanted to bring up denial numbers, or point C. It almost seems out of place, almost as if it's that should be in some other article someplace else. How exactly does that relate to the church being responsible for bringing in the kingdom?
I think it has to do with the leadership there. I saw that when I first went through this. I thought, is that out of place? Except that the church is leading the charge. And if we're going to lead, we have to be humble servants in the church. But we are, it's one of the major thrusts of what we're hoping to do here is to develop leadership skills. First, we hope to develop leadership in family, and then in church, and then move out. And then we move into the civil sphere and our social sphere and lead. Family, church, and then our society. So I believe that that's how that relates. That's how I came to look at it.
Now, can you just back up and do that for B as well? Applying biblical principles to the stewardship of all earthly creation, detract from the believer's heavenly hope. Is that just putting too much emphasis on creation and not on the Creator?
Yeah.
Okay.
Thank you.
So we're just worshiping the wrong thing.
Well, one example of that would be if you have some conversation with someone and you talk about maybe some things that you're excited about in terms of maybe ways you're going through the kingdom or any type of physical activity, and that person would say, well, that's great, but this earth is not our home, you know. For me, I think that maybe speaks to that type of an attitude, that one being not concerned with anything earthly because, you know, this isn't our home.
Okay.
And so abandoning any responsibility or effort, I think that might be what we're talking about.
Agreed. Angel.
Say this earth is not my home. Give me all your money. Right now. Apparently it is your home. Yeah, I mean the earth is our home while we're here. But it seems like the idea of the earth not being our home just goes to any responsibility that I myself am not concerned with. From my shrubs.
Well, it sounds so spiritual. The earth is not my home. I'm above all. And in a sense, that may be the same kind of backpedaling that says, oh, I'm just waiting for the rapture. I'm not going to do anything. This earth isn't my home anyway. Why should I get involved? And it's easy to do because there is so much discouraging activity. To say, well, let God sort this out. I'm just gonna read my Bible and not worry about it. Yeah. No, we have to be good stewards and look for the long term. Long term, really. Could be thousands of years. We've talked about this before where Deuteronomy talks about thousands of generations. Generations are being generous and saying only 20 years. Generations to the non-believers. Then we have at least 40,000 years, two generations. We're in it historically 6,000 years, so we've got at least 34,000 years to go. Let's not look expectantly for Christ anytime immediately. There's lots to get done before he comes back. And that's the point. We're the church. Let's get it done. Advance in the kingdom. All right. Article number 27 is entitled The Kingdom of God in Heaven. We affirm, A, that our primary citizenship is in heaven, though we are citizens of earthly nations as well. We affirm, B, that heaven is our true home and treasure. C, that the Bible teaches us to be heavenly minded, and that only heavenly minded men and women are useful for God on earth. D, that we are seated in the heavenly places to rule in and with Christ. E, that heaven is the pattern for earth. And F, that we are to live an eager expectation of our being with the Lord in heaven and of Christ's second coming in glory when heaven shall come down to earth in fullness. We deny, A, that our heavenly citizenship reduces our responsibilities in society, we deny B, that our expectation of heaven and Christ's coming gives us permission to neglect our duties in this world. So this addresses some things that we just talked about. Our primary citizenship is in heaven. We are primarily citizens of God's kingdom. God's kingdom covers heaven and earth. But we are primarily citizens of heaven. But we cannot deny citizenship, our earthly national citizenship. That's an important thing to keep in mind, that we do have to live here while we're here. We are citizens. We have some patriotic duty to attend to as citizens of the United States. And yet we need to be, as it goes on to say, we need to be heavenly minded. We need to be looking forward and having that long, long view that says, this God is the King, and we are primarily His citizens, citizens of His nation. We are the Lord's subjects. And that heaven is indeed our true treasure. We will be with the Lord forever. But heaven, don't forget, is coming here and at the end of the law, when the earth is renewed and purified, refined in the fire, and perfected. So we'll be back. We'll be working here on earth as resurrected citizens of heaven. We only heavenly minded men and women are useful for God on earth. I think it's probably understandable if we are heavenly minded indeed. We're seated already in heavenly places, and there are proof texts in here for us that we're probably all familiar with regarding that. Heaven is the pattern for earth. It gets us back to the Lord's Prayer, doesn't it? Where we're praying that His kingdom come, His will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Well, obviously, if that's what we're praying for, we are admitting, we are recognizing the pattern that is in heaven is already, it is to be done here as well. And it does not, when we talk about point number F here, where it says we live in eager expectation of our being with the Lord in heaven and Christ's second coming, when heaven shall come down to earth in fullness, doesn't negate anything that we just talked about, where we shouldn't be, where I said we shouldn't be just hanging out on the mountaintops waiting for Christ to come back. We should live in the expectation of that. We have a terrific hope of all of those things, but that doesn't mean that we can live in those expectations and neglect our responsibilities. That's not at all what that's saying. We are to live in eager expectation of being with the Lord in heaven. That gives us that long view that we were just talking about. And our heavenly citizenship does not reduce our responsibility. We're hammering on that in these past two articles. The proof texts. That our primary citizenship is in heaven, Psalm 27:4, one thing I have desired for the Lord, that will I seek after, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to behold the beauty of the Lord, inquire in His temple. And there are a lot of proof texts for that particular one. That our heaven is our true home and treasure. We have the very familiar Matthew passage, lay not up for yourselves treasure upon earth, where moth and rust doth corrupt, where thieves break in through steal, but lay up for yourselves treasure in heaven, where neither moth nor rust doth corrupt, and where thieves do not break through nor steal. But where your treasure is, there will your heart be also. Great reminders. The proof text for the Bible teaches us to be heavenly minded, and only then will we be useful for God on earth. Luke, the 12:31-34 passage would seem to address that. Rather, seek ye the kingdom of God, and all these things shall be added unto you. It goes on from there. And I would encourage you to read through all these proof texts and really kind of consider them in light of what's being affirmed and denied in this creed. It's a very convicting study. For those of you who may not have a handout, if you'd like to email me, I'll be happy to send these things out to you. That's jfbing@yahoo.com. I'll be happy to send them out. So do we have any questions or concerns about our Article 27 here of the Kingdom of God in Heaven?
Well, I've never really done much studying about heaven, and I've never really heard anyone talk about it or preach about it. And I'm sure it could be a long answer, but I mean, my concept of heaven is that there's a place somewhere in another world that's heaven, where Jesus sits at the right hand of God. And then, do I understand that if so when Jesus comes again, then that heaven will then come to earth? And then, where heaven will always be for forever, then? It's not like then people go back to that other world place. Is that the proper concept, or is that...
Well, I don't want to be the final authority on the proper concept of heaven. Well, I have my idea on that. My thinking on that is that when we die, we're absent from the body and present with the Lord. So there's this period of time now that I'll be a spiritual. I will be in the spiritual presence of the Lord. Clothed in white, whatever that means. I'll be given a covering of some sort. But ultimately, God created man as a mind, body, spirit, body being. It's unnatural for us to be separated. Man was not meant to die. God created man. There was not death until there was sin. So man didn't die until we had the sin. And then we have this unnatural state. That's why the body fights so hard at the end of life to hang on to it. It's this separation of spirit and body is wrenching. And we really fight hard to hang on to that. We will be resurrected. We know that. Bodily, physically resurrected. And built to last for eternity. But built to live in that glorified state, resurrected state, to be able to bear the sight of an exalted Christ and live with him forever. Where? Well, when you read in a lot of the Puritans, we'll talk about, we're sitting in it right now. This is where. But the earth was subjected to corruption when there was sin. If the earth and the universe hadn't been subjected to corruption, we would be imperfect beings living in a perfect creation. Well, that wouldn't work very well either. So, while we're here, while the kingdom is advancing, and we are fulfilling the original mandate, which was be fruitful, multiply, subdue the earth for the glory of God, while we're advancing that agenda, and until Christ returns, at the consummation of all these things, we have this corrupted earth. Then, the earth will be destroyed by fire. Destroyed, it'll go through the refiner's fire, and the corruption will be removed. The dross from the, you know, like when they refine silver and gold, that'll be removed. And the earth, the new earth, and the new heavens perfected will be in a certain place. And that's where we will live. So that's my view of it. There are, looking for the, well, I had marked a text on that. But if you go into Revelation, and you read the accounts of the new heavens and the new earth and new Jerusalem, and you read it with that particular perspective that I just described in mind, you'll start to see what I'm going to talk about. And I got this thinking from reading some of the Puritans. Thomas Goodwin is one, and I can't recall the second name at the moment. But that's the viewpoint that I have. Is it just as we are going to have physical bodies, we're going to live on a physical earth. It's just been perfected. So it may be new teaching to you. It was new teaching to me, but when I first came to Christ, I came to it very, from a point of view where everything was spiritual. It was all just floating around and angels with wings, and you know, it was very nebulous. So when you really start to study, I can still remember getting smacked with the idea that it's physical resurrection. It's bodily, real resurrection. Not just this spiritual one. Well, if we have a body, it makes perfect sense that we also have a physical earth to exist. I think that one of the things that you never see, and I'm looking out of place on this, but one of the things you never see or read about in the Bible is blood in the new heavens and new earth. Christ's blood was spilled for us, but even when Christ was glorified and comes back, and you can stick your finger in his side, there's no talk about blood. And so the life is in the blood, right? But the life is in the blood. The blood is always in the sacrifice. So it seems that after our resurrection, I just don't know what's going on, but you never read any more about blood. Maybe it's just because it's in the story. Number of things about the new heavens and the new earth. There's a lot of things that we just aren't going to know. It doesn't talk extensively about how that's going to work. I think hell is talked about more than any, by far, than heaven, because I think that it's more important that people understand what they're being saved from than what they're being saved to. I hope that answers some satisfaction. Yeah. And if someone wants to take issue with me on this, this is Heaven by John Bingham, and it's frightening me. Frightening to even say it. Okay. Article number 28, the Bible is the plumb line for all nations. We affirm that the kingdom task of making disciples of all nations requires us to hold forth the Bible as God's standard and plumb line by which to measure the justice, morality, and practice of all human endeavors in all jurisdictions, individual, voluntary, association, family, church, and civil government. I want to read that again. We affirm that the kingdom task of making disciples of all nations requires us to hold forth the Bible as God's standard and plumb line by which to measure the justice, morality, and practice of all human endeavors in all jurisdictions, individual, voluntary association, family, church, and civil government. We deny, A, that the Bible and its view of reality binds only those who voluntarily claim the mission and are irrelevant to those who reject them. We also deny that unwillingness relieves anyone of the duty to believe and obey the Bible. That is a distinctive view for for IRBC. There are churches who will not affirm that. It's for everyone and for all time. Doesn't matter if people deny it. There is a God. He is perfect. He is just. He, as a perfect and just God, requires perfection and justice of his subjects, whether or not they believe. As parents, we have children who, from time to time, will say, well, I deny that. It doesn't matter if you do it. Mommy says, and that's the way it's going to be. And we have a God who expects these things. So denying it does not relieve us of any responsibility to obey and submit to the King. After all, this discussion is in the context of the kingdom. A vitally important topic. Why don't I open this up to discussion before? Anybody have any problems with this idea that the Bible is the thumb line for all nations, for every individual, for every association, and that voluntary acceptance is the only way to receive? Nobody has a
question. I have a question.
Yes.
So he was asking about heaven.
Yes.
So I'm just wondering, because someone had presented this idea to me years ago. They said, well, if heaven is a place of eternal darkness.
Of eternal darkness?
And yet there's fire. How do those two combine together? And so they posited that, is there one that's figurative, like you feel the darkness, or you feel as if you're on fire? Because how can you have darkness and fire at the same time? So it was something I've been thinking about for a few years, and I don't know if you had any thought on that.
I think that maybe the darkness is the figurative part of that. That's the way I read it. I think that the darkness in that respect is the aloneness.
Mm-hmm. Almost like, not that the children would see it, but most adults have seen Shawshank Redemption, where you're in solitary confinement in the dark forever.
Yes.
That's kind of how, when someone asks me about it, that's the best I could give, but where do I get scriptural on any positive point on that?
Right. And we just don't know. I think that we can take... There's a sense in which we can take it both ways, literally, because we don't know, in the same way that we don't know how can a body be resurrected and physically perfected. How can a body be resurrected and prepared for eternal damnation, to be able to withstand the punishment for eternity? How does that happen? In the same way, perhaps there's fire without light in hell. Is it heat? You can have heat without the fire.
Right. It just seems like, you know, again, like what you say, a lot of the churches are teaching or whatever, you always see these pictures of fire all the time. And
yep.
Is that the literal? And but then you see other ones where everything's dark and
yes.
Lurky.
Right.
So which, how can you have both? So anyway, I
right.
guess
you'll
it's just a matter of...
Yeah, and you'll see pictures of hell with Satan in charge. And Satan's not in charge.
Oh, that's a good point.
You know, so... We're looking at people's conceptions of these things, and then we don't know what was their biblical belief. Are they even Christian?
Yeah.
So we got to be a little bit careful about dealing with those issues, and just we can take the Bible at its word. It's
Not a good place, no matter what.
Just interesting that the scriptures present Christ as light, so any place where Christ
is not,
has a spiritual darkness to me.
Yeah, great point. Spiritual darkness. And that separation. And there's this, yes, you've often heard it says it, there's going to being in hell is eternal separation from God. And there's a sense in which that's just not true. You're perhaps in the eternal presence of a wrathful God. You're separated from the comfortable presence of God, I think is how the Westminster Confession puts it, the comfortable presence of God. But you're not separated from his presence. He's there and active in hell, which is truly frightening. And, yes.
Where do we see that distinction in Scripture, though?
Distinction of?
The comfortable presence versus the wrathful presence. And it's often accepted that there is that separation from God if one is in hell. And I need to ask the same question to that, too, but where does Scripture say that he is or is not in hell?
Sure.
That population.
Yeah, I can't find it right now, but David said that if I descended to heaven, you were there.
39, 139.
39, 139. I descended to hell.
Yeah. Okay. Let's just take a quick look. Psalm 139. Where can I go from your spirit? Where can I flee from your presence? When I ascend to heaven, you are there. If I make my bed in Sheol, behold, you are there. Sheol often being the Old Testament word for hell. So there's a passage. There's a cross reference. I'm going to do a little word search. Let me look that up. Where does it say that God is there? That's a great question. The comfortable, I think that it's also, when we studied the Westminster Confession, we talked about in the very first chapter, we talk about the Word of God and its inerrancy, and that we deduce from the Scriptures what we must. Like the Trinity is not mentioned per se in the Scriptures. We deduce it from passages. Well, we know that we're going to live in the light of God's presence in heaven, and we also know that God is everywhere in the universe, all at once, all the time, all three persons of the Godhead are omnipresent everywhere in everything. That would have to include hell. Okay. Right.
Doesn't he say he removes his presence at times?
He'll withdraw a restraining hand. He'll withdraw his. Yeah, his presence, but I think that's that comfortable presence, or that if he withdraws his restraint or his comfort from us for a time, that is a chastisement. Those, and I think it's often talked about in those terms. I know that the Confession talks about that, where when you're justified, you're always justified. But there are times when, in his fatherly concern for us because of our sins, he will withdraw for a time, or he will chastise us. And sometimes those things are talked about as interchangeable. His withdrawal and his chastisement. His withdrawal is his chastisement. And we have those dark, dry periods. But I think that God, as the avenger, when we get into this whole doctrine of hell, God is avenging his justice. He is, every sin ever committed will be paid for. It was either paid for by Christ on the cross, or it will be paid for in the bodies of the sinners who are not aware. And so, who is inflicting the punishment? Well, it's God. He's the one who is the avenger. I think it's a necessary deduction that we say that God is punishing in hell the wicked. I don't know how to escape that. Heard it. Did everybody hear that? Ray said that when Christ was on the cross and cried out, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? That there's this idea of the separation. I've often heard that talked about, that as God turned his back on his son and he was, for the first time ever in his existence, had a separation from God the Father. And yet, the despair there could also have been that Christ, in his mortality, is crying out in his pain, in his agony. Plus, the bearing of the punishment of all the sins of all the elect is that we think about hell and how gruesome that would be for us as individuals, and then multiply that by billions upon billions of people, and there are billions on billions of sins all being punished in the body of Christ on the cross. The forsaking could have been, that he was talking about there, could have simply been a giant ouch. Why does it have to be like this? Why have you forsaken me in this? I don't know. I'm positive. Truly, Joel.
There's different senses in which this could be talked about. For example, in Peter's sermon in Acts 2, where he quotes the Psalms, and he's talking about Christ's death on the cross. I foresaw the Lord always before my face, for he is at my right hand that I may not be shaken. Therefore my heart rejoiced, my tongue was glad. Moreover, my flesh will rest in hope, for you will not leave my soul in Hades, nor will you allow your holy one to see corruption. You have made known to me the paths of life. And he uses that, you allow your holy one to see corruption, meaning decay, and then argues that this was not David, because David's still on the ground. But he was talking about Christ. Christ's body never did decay. Well, earlier in the passage, he's quoting the passage to say that God was always with Christ in some sort of sense, because it says, I foresaw the Lord always before my face, for he is my right hand. So somehow he saw his Father, even though he was forsaken, somehow he still saw his Father always before him. And I can't necessarily explain this, except to say there's a couple of senses that people talk about.
Yes. How do we as finite beings understand God? It's impossible. It's not just difficult. It's impossible. Our finite brains can't get around it. Can't get our thoughts around the entirety of the Godhead, or the God-Man, the humanity and the divinity in Christ Jesus. It's a mystery revealed happened, but how? And what was the nature of it? We'll never understand. We can accept this choice and worship in all. Okay. So, the kingdom of God and heaven, and we talk about hell as well. Any more on that? Okay. I'm going to pull mine for all nations. Yes, oh, sorry.
Just a question about the plumb line.
Yes.
Unwillingness to release anyone from the duties of believing the day of the Bible. So, I mean, like today, we have plenty of unwilling people. If that makes sense.
Lots of unwilling. Bill Nye.
Very unwilling. So what do we do with those people? You know what I mean? They don't have excuse. I mean, they don't have any excuses to, you know, to deny Christ. I mean, so what is our duty? Just to tell them and then let them do what they want? You know, I mean, is it, you know, is there any sort of justice that has to be enacted upon those people? Or...
That's a multiple part.
Okay.
People who will not, or who are... One of the things that we talked about actually in the question and answer, people who are self-consciously anti-Christian will suffer more lashes than people who are unself-consciously anti-Christian, because they are really actively working against God. They are active enemies as opposed to passive enemies. What do we do with them? We preach to them. We present them with the gospel, and we pray that the Holy Spirit would apply it. That's all we can do with anybody. That's true of the inactive enemies and the active enemies. We present the gospel. We present the gospel. As Seth pointed out, and also in the Q&A, people already stand condemned. And as he's pointed out previously, as we now know, we're without excuse. Everyone knows. Everyone knows. And we can suppress the truth in unrighteousness, but we all have that in us. We have the works of the law written in our heart. And so we have that no excuse issue to deal with. So by our proclaiming it to these people, and those who won't come, we're heaping coals on their head. The punishment or the justice that we need to execute on anyone gets into an idea of we need to enact biblical laws here on earth. All law is only truly valid and legitimate if it conforms to the laws put forth in the Bible. So we have the ideal justice system put forward. When we execute justice is when people have violated those laws properly enacted. You know, so we would like to see what we work towards as we try to redeem our culture, if we try to work towards enacting a biblical law so that the laws that we have here on earth conform to the Bible. And then, as people violate those laws, we execute judgment upon them, properly tried, you know, with witnesses and the whole biblical law procedure. I don't think it's legitimate for us to execute judgment on our own. For instance, for our church to go and try Bill Nye for blaspheming and then execute him for blasphemy, I don't think that's really going to fly. I don't think that's what we're called to. I think that we're called to be prophets of God. We are to proclaim the word and send it forth and let the Holy Spirit work, and as people become more and more Christian, we will end up with more and more biblical law, and then we will have more people like Bill Nye would be reticent to blaspheme, because now say what you will about that debate, it was mostly respectful for Christians. It was not deliberately insulting and dismissive. He didn't lash and sneer and snort as we read in today's psalm. Out loud. You could see it if you read between the lines in the white space kind of thing, but he tried very hard to be polite in the debate. How much more so if everybody around him is Christian? He might still hold a view, but he's going to tamp that down. He's going to temper that and not be as outspoken about it. And the less outspoken people are, and seemingly getting away with it, again, as we read in today's psalm, where people just are unrighteous and wicked with impunity, they won't be so when the world is largely Christianized. And that's what we're working towards. That's what the kingdom advancement is about. So does that answer what you were getting at, Tim?
Just to piggyback on that a little bit, I think one thing I'm learning is actually use the word, not concepts or ideas or what you know, what I say it says. What does the actual word of God say? So actually use the word. And I think you know, it's just the word won't have void either. So you know, it's something I'm learning that to try to practice more is actually use the word with whoever it is, whether it's people who don't believe it or not, but actually use the word, and their word will not go out of the way.
Yeah. I think it's terrific to the Bible memorization, to be able to do those kinds of things in our interaction with people. But I wouldn't shy away from the concepts as well. Simply because, as we were discussing in the confession, when we were talking about good and necessary consequence, deduced from the scripture, that the meaning of the scripture is just as valid as the scripture, the actual words themselves. You know, if you get so pure about it, that all you're doing is speaking Greek. And, you know, and then they're not going to get it. So it's a legitimate thing to talk about, just as it's legitimate for a pastor to stand up here and give a sermon without using just the words from the Bible. That would be a recitation, not a sermon. So, but I think that we should, we need to be less embarrassed than we've been about talking about the Bible, the verses, and what it means. We have two to go. We're running just a little behind. I'm gonna try. No, you know what? Because we're gonna try to tie all the kingdom stuff together next week. We'll have two more articles to do. We'll wrap up the kingdom with a little bit more discussion about it and its importance, and then we will start on Israel and the church next week. So I know we're running over on what our original plan was on the distinctives, but let's give it its proper name. So let's close prayer. And Father, we thank you that we are subjects. We ask that you would humble us, that you would give us regular reminders, that you would prick our consciences and our hearts as we promote our own agenda over yours. We pray that you would bring to mind your agenda at every opportunity as we interact with our friends, our family, our co-workers, those that we meet with in society, that we would be not shy about proclaiming your kingship, your lordship, your justice, what we owe, what our friends, families, neighbors owe you. In this life, we know that you will succeed in history because it's your history. You started it, you will end it, and you will have your way. We pray that you would allow us to be part of it. We're privileged to be part of it, and we thank you for it. In Christ's name.